So my name is Rodolfo Gonzalez. I'm a partner at Foundation Capital. I know if you look in your booklet, you will have a different name. My partner, Charles Moldau, who unfortunately couldn't make it at the last minute. And so they sent the replacement at the last minute. But I'm very glad to be here with a friend and founder, Matt. Matt's an amazing guy, and I've had the privilege to know him and work with him now for about 4 years, and pretty much since the beginning of the Lenny Home story. And it just keeps getting better and better, and so I'm excited to spend the next few minutes with him. So, Matt, do you want to tell us a little bit about yourself?
Thanks so much, Rodolfo. So, quick background, I'm Matt Humphrey, co-founder and CEO of Lending Home, next generation online mortgage platform. We'll talk a bit about that in a second. My background is really kind of up and down the tech world since, I guess, the last 13 years or so, building companies. Kind of all the way from a 3D virtual worlds company to peer-to-peer video delivery to some early things in social games and Facebook apps, all the way up through my last business, which was an e-commerce company called Home Run that we built and sold back in 2011 and had the privilege of working with Rodolfo on that. So after selling that, I was actually looking for a simple, transparent, online way to invest in real estate. And actually, my co-founder and a bunch of friends and family were just also on the other side having the absolute worst time getting a mortgage. When we look and we see, you know, cost to produce a loan from banks at about $8,000, and we look at closing times roughly 2 months, and we look at net promoter scores of traditional mortgage providers being zero, if not negative many times, we saw a massive opportunity to start Lending Home at the end of 2013 and really bring borrowers and investors directly together and redefine how mortgages are done with technology at the core. So that's what we built. Quick background on Lending Home. We started end of 13. We spent the first 9 months basically saying, what if you took all the guts of a mortgage bank, built it with tech from the ground up, how you acquire customers, online customer experience, data, credit, automated operations, servicing, a private investor marketplace, and all the details in between, and all of that operated on one core tech platform versus gluing together 10, 20, 30 disparate external systems. So we built that over the first 9 months, started lending about three and a half years ago, approaching our $2 billionth lent, all the way from some very esoteric mortgage products like what we call bridge loans or financing real estate investors, all the way to 30-year fixed home mortgages for first-time home buyers, right? And it's one key residential mortgage platform that powers that no matter what the use case is. So we've scaled the business. We've raised over $165 million of equity to date. We've scaled the business to about 300 people, doubling or tripling the business year over year. And it's been a delight to work with you guys as part of the journey.
Yeah, very, very excited. You also had some really good news coming up recently.
So last week we announced another $57 million of equity from from a handful of strategic investors around the world. We announced a new kind of $400 million dedicated balance sheet to fund loans in a 3-year fixed income fund. And we announced that we're kind of well over $100 million a month of new originations and loan volume. So capital is as strong as ever on both sides, equity and the loan side. And we're growing and scaling the business quickly, which is great.
That's amazing. Just very, very proud.
Having fun.
It's such a unique opportunity, and the sector that you're targeting is fascinating. I want to switch a little bit because you mentioned a really substantial equity raise, and within the online lending space, things have been really tough for the past couple of years. Can you tell us a little bit more how was the experience raising this latest round, which is pretty substantial?
Yeah, so we had raised our last round in 2015. We had had a substantial number of strategics in our orbit, and we hadn't had a vehicle open for a long time. So anywhere from folks that could help on the loan capital side or access to foreign capital markets or just you know, expertise and knowledge in kind of mortgage operations or real estate. So what, you know, we opened a vehicle, pulled that together, and really was able to finance our next phase of growth. You know, for us, that capital goes right back into tech, building up that platform. And especially as we think about kind of competing, you know, we think of ourselves as almost David versus Goliath competing against the big banks. We don't have nearly the kind of the balance sheet, the kind of the total resources, but as a scrappy startup, really controlling all elements of our own infrastructure from the ground up, we think we can actually compete and win.
What are you the most proud of the technology that you've built?
Yeah, so I think when people think about online lending, I think of people's minds, or at least kind of, let's say, 3 or 4 years ago, people's minds went to sexy online consumer experience, make it a few clicks to get your financial product, make it easy, you know, all about that kind of UI in front end. And I think our investment here at Lending Home has probably about 80% has been the guts and the internals of the platform, making quality loans, putting huge pieces of the underwriting process on rails, looking for fundamental efficiency advantages by leveraging tech and not just, you know, underwriters that have been in the space for 30 plus years. So I think, you know, that focus on the internal unit economics, the focus on core technology, driving that process and looking at that in a completely different way, is something that if you just look at our website, yeah, you can do a few clicks, it's much faster, it's easy, it's online, it's transparent, but it's really the guts of that platform that makes it special. And so when we look at ourselves, again, in the David versus Goliath approach, you know, we don't have a legacy tech system that's 30 years old. We don't have a legacy employee base that's, you know, 10,000 or 100,000 strong. We get to rewrite the rule book, if you will, on how that's done. And so I would say all of the unsexy details in the back office are what really makes it go.
Yeah. It's fascinating. Within this perspective, what is your, I mean, within Foundation, we have this notion of tech versus fin, and we clearly, you know, you are kind of like the paradigm of founder that we like backing, like the tech first, but the fin is really, really important because otherwise it doesn't work. What's your perspective from that side?
Yeah, I mean, we would say, especially in mortgage, it has to be a balance. We talk about the holy trinity of you need to have fundamental tech advantage, right? There's over 7,000 mortgage companies in the U.S., and if you slap together the same systems, the same processes, and just look at things the same way, you're not going to have something fundamentally different. I think there's very little opportunities in this segment for pure business model advantage. It has to be fundamental tech advantage. So that's one. So that's the tech side. You know, deep financial DNA, because capital is key, and it's a massive part of the equation. And then mortgage itself as an asset class is kind of unique and kind of weird. You know, it's so details oriented that we have balanced that tech DNA with that deep financial DNA with hardcore mortgage operations DNA that have been in the industry for 30 or 40 years. Sometimes it can be really hard to get that culture to play well together and get that holy trinity to balance. But I think we'd be, you know, if you only have two legs of that three, no matter which two you have, it finds a way to fall down. I think we've managed it well, but I think that, again, if you're going to do something truly different, there has to be a true tech edge.
I've talked to a couple of corporate and strategic investors and also you know, just corporate partners of Foundation across the time, and there is a little bit of frustration with once they start digging into what's really under the hood in these lending companies, they don't know what truly there is that is unique or of value, right? It's you end up having a black box underwriting engine that is subscale relative to what they need to do. You end up having not a proprietary channel of originations. And so they feel like, what am I buying? What am I paying for? I don't want to bail out the equity, the venture guys. Do you get those types of questions from them, or when you talk to some of these strategic partners and investors?
Yeah, I think almost everybody that we brought into this last round was somehow tied to either the asset management side of the house that's bought, you know, millions of loans in their day, and, you know, has deep experience knowing what a quality platform or process looks like, and not, you know, banks and other players who also participated in the round certainly can look inward and can see you know, when we get under the hood and walk them through, we've got a technology presentation of almost 250 slides that's each individual piece of the platform. And it's frankly a little bit crazy to take people through it. But once they go through and say, wait, this is all one system, it's all integrated from the first time someone sees a display ad featuring lendinghome.com through the last servicing payment, it is end to end in one platform. I think that's where we tend to get a little bit of a wow reaction and say whether the right way is to partner on assets, whether the right way is to, you know, partner with you to kind of help drive consumers to you, or just frankly learn from you and how you guys have structured the technology. I think that's the reaction we tend to get.
And when you were raising this last round, obviously considering the context of how challenging it has been for lending startups to get funding, to get like capital dried up last year, dried up again at the beginning of the year. How did you make that decision of, okay, let's bring this group of interesting people with different, sometimes even competing in interest into the tent? And for the entrepreneurs that are here in the room, when do you recommend that they start seriously considering bringing these folks in versus staying with
So you're saying strategics versus traditional
exactly.
venture capital. Yeah, so I mean, we've had the pleasure of partnering with Foundation, First Round, Ribbit Capital, and so great folks, yourself, Charles, Mickey around the table. I think through those first couple rounds, it's very critical to get that mentorship, even as an nth time entrepreneur now, still just so many ups and downs, so many learning lessons. But I think as soon as businesses start to hit a scale where those partnerships can come into play, where you know, the capital required to fund the business on any given year or two is really non-negligible, right? I think you kind of gas and clutch off of the value that a true traditional venture side can bring versus strategic. So we opted for that basically kind of 3 years in, as we had passed $1 billion in originations and going to kind of north of $1 billion a year. It just felt right. But I think these businesses are super capital intensive. And, you know, again, going back to David and Goliath, right, it's most mortgage companies in the U.S., private ones, are funded by a couple $1 million of private equity. It's hard to build something different with maybe $1 million technology budget, yeah. Right? So starting with venture, cutting deep, building something special, and then when it's truly economics or money to fund the growth of the business, the scale, the operational scale, et cetera, that's when it's probably time to shift.
So give advice to the entrepreneurs in the room. Like, I've been hearing more and more the cases of I'm raising my seed round and X bank or this insurance company is trying to lead my seed round. Would you recommend it? Would you go against that?
Probably not. I mean, I think that maybe that's unpopular or counterintuitive, but I think you know the first steps out of the gate are fundamentally getting product market fit, fundamentally building tech platform. You know, those early days of growing and scaling culture, and again thinking different. So it feels like it's probably a bit too early to jump into a true strategic. It can also send weird signaling, and it can also cut other potential capital partners out if it's a true lending business because they feel like that's you know, kind of allocated to that specific partner.
Yep. Yeah. That makes sense. Okay. We have a few questions, but let's just keep going a little bit here. So when you look at your peers in other verticals within lending, what's your perspective? What's going to happen?
Yeah, it feels like we certainly see a ton of activity in like adjacent services to what we do today. So I bet you'll see a bunch of insurance businesses around the home pop up. I'm sure you'll see a bunch of title businesses around the home pop up, right? But not necessarily in kind of core, you know, let's say, you know, marketplace lending for mortgage, we don't see that many new entrants. The core lending verticals are very capital intensive. So it does feel like, you know, kind of one or two winners at most are emerging in each category. And now like the remaining venture capital, the kind of the growth rounds and kind of those next phases are going to be reserved for who those winners are. I think 3 or 4 years ago, you were seeing just tons of players and it was frankly hard to distinguish, you know, who was going to stand out or not. So I think core lending, probably just one or two winners in each vertical at most. And then I think across the across a lot of the ancillary services and support services around them, still a very robust ecosystem.
Yep. Yeah. All right, so Matt, by the way, is also a very prolific angel investor. And I wanna take this opportunity as well to just get a little bit of wisdom from him, because he we've co-invested also in a couple of companies. But what are the two or three things that you look for when you're talking to founders?
Yeah, I'd say if I had to nail it down to three things, I'd say one is just excellent founders. I think there's a massive premium in how awesome the idea and the tech has to be if they're first time, but certainly a lot of first timers succeed. So it's kind of like that proven, trusted entrepreneur. There are so many ups and downs of starting a company, and just having that grit and that wherewithal to see it through and to get creative when is needed, I think is key. The second is, is the founder or on the founding team substantial tech DNA? Again, especially as it relates to this space, fintech, real estate tech, et cetera, it's that true tech DNA that's going to think different. And is there a real tech advantage, right? How can you articulate it? For us, you could articulate it in NPS and experience. For us, you could articulate it in cut the cost to close a loan from $8,000 down to two or three, pass that savings back to a customer. Very clear, very simple to understand. When I look at investments, it's things like that. And then just massive market. Right. You'd hate to win 20-30% of something and still have a medium-sized business.
Which companies do you regret not having invested in?
Ooh, really put me on the spot there. knew Eric at the early days of Open Door. Didn't push go on that. Ooh. One. There's many. It's not in my brain right now, but we track my kind of my non-investment list.
The anti-portfolio,
and it's kind of depressing.
Yeah.
It really is.
It's wild.
Yep.
All right, let's take, I want to take some from the audience.
Sure.
All right, so the first one is, okay, why did you decide to become an originator rather than licensing the technology to other lenders?
Yeah, so for us, we actually think that we're firm believers that I think the folks that kind of Blend and otherwise are doing a nice job and are building a really great business. But I think when we think about doing something truly special for customers, it's not airlifting software into kind of the same culture, the same processes, et cetera. So we like to think, building something special in terms of the people we're putting together to be customer first, the way we're building our culture and our operational processes internally, and the tech is again that trifecta that makes this really special. Yeah. And we just think that, if you'd rather dig for gold or sell really, really good shovels, we're just of the mindset we'd rather dig for gold. Yep. It's harder, it's more capital intensive, it's grittier, but we think it leads to the bigger outcome if we succeed.
Yeah. Do you leverage other technologies in the underwriting process, or is it all your system?
Yeah, so the way we've chosen to look at this is that we do everything from kind of that front end advertising through the experience, through the operations, and underwriting through the servicing side. We will pull in third-party data sources, so we'll have over 50 different sources of data that come into the platform end-to-end. But the core of the workflow, the core UI, the core rules engine, where, for instance, hundreds if not thousands of checks can be run on each individual loan to make sure it meets credit policy.
Yep.
So it doesn't have to live in an underwriter's head. It can live directly in the system. All of that is proprietary. So to be able to support such a wide range of mortgage products and be able to do that, that was something that we couldn't, we looked across the space, we couldn't outsource. That is that lifeblood, that is that fundamental benefit. So
yep. It took a while to build.
It did, and it's still ongoing, but we think it's powerful. And when we look and we say, one of the benefits of designing the process from end to end, I believe in the industry as of earlier this year, the average salesperson was able to close about 3.7 loans per month. Our comp plan averages are set at 21. Right, so when you think about kind of transitioning kind of feet on the street, grinding sales to online and more of a support model where the operations and underwriting is efficient, where customers can walk up and 70-80% actually self-serve through the application with no need for a handhold, right? That fundamentally changes the game economically, customer experience-wise, NPS, et cetera. So that's why it's so important that we dug deep.
So what are some of the goals that you have for the next year? Like when you're on stage next year, how do you see this ecosystem evolving for you?
Yeah, I think 20 seconds here, so I'll try to condense a year into 15 seconds. I think for us, we started, I think we're gonna probably try to at least double the business again which we think because of our tech and not just people first approach, we can do. And to really, really just start to push the gas on our consumer mortgage offering. You know, we compete, we have both products that banks don't lend into, as well as compete directly with banks and others, and we think we can thrive on both sides of the house. So more tech, more scale, and just, you know, keep hammering the fundamentals of unit economics.
Nice. Yeah. Well, so, we're out on time.
The red light.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone.
Cool. It's
been a pleasure to be here.
Thanks.